the long-awaited main theme for Obi-Wan Kenobi was recently released with John Williams at the helm. It's incredible to see the legacy of Star Wars from its inception with Williams in 1977 all the way to present day, with composers Ludwig Göransson and Natalie Holt taking the reins in their respective series. Williams returned to the project with convincing from series director Deborah Chow, and she talked about how the fact that there was never a dedicated theme for Obi-Wan Kenobi became a deciding factor for Williams to take on this piece. Due to his consistently busy touring schedule, he only had time to work on this one cue, but there's a satisfying sense of cohesion upon listening to it, bringing back certain devices and ideas that evoke that classic Star Wars sound. Interestingly, Obi-Wan's theme has sparked quite a bit of controversy, with some claiming it sounds nothing like John Williams, or he was simply disinterested while writing it, or even that a ghostwriter wrote it for him. On the other hand, many others say it's his best work to date, with mature writing and lush orchestration taking center stage and solidifying the piece among Williams' greatest. In any case, let's take a look at the theme itself and analyze some of its techniques to see what we can draw from Williams' toolkit. Due to copyright reasons, I'll demonstrate a piano rendition of this theme instead of the original orchestral score, but this gives us a great opportunity to strip away any flourishes and drill down to the core musical material, which in my opinion is the best way to study our favorite composers. Just before we begin, I'd love to give you a free gift to help you with your own composing workflow. It's a super short PDF guide that goes over a four-step process to take you from initial idea to completed master, and it's designed to be practical and instantly applicable. If you're ready to compose with efficiency and equip yourself with a clear framework, then this is the perfect guide for you. Just click the first link in the description box and you can download it absolutely free. All right, let's dive in. The cue is essentially constructed as an extended period with a full 18-bar theme split into two halves. The first 9 bars can be looked at as a period in itself, with the first line ending with an implied authentic cadence and the second line with a half cadence. This is a reversal of what we would typically expect, with the first phrase usually ending on a half cadence to ask a question and the responding second phrase ending things off nicely with an authentic cadence. However, due to the nature of this reversal, Williams is kind of informing us that these first two lines are actually comprising the entire question phrase or the antecedent, and there's more to come to create the resolution or the consequent phrase. Let's have a listen. In terms of orchestration, we begin with a beautiful string tremolo on a high C, which is a very common orchestration device used to create suspense and lightness. Also, the fact that this tremolo is played on a high C gives the solo horn plenty of room to perform the melody in the C3 to C4 register, or just above middle C. Williams and his orchestrators are masters at understanding that less is usually more, with these two contrasting mediums creating a sense of regality, purpose, and respect. The beauty of this theme lies in its simplicity, which is one of the most difficult things to do consistently. Creating a memorable theme that doesn't sound cheesy and overly simplistic, but is simple enough for most lay people to grasp. The fact that we're in C minor is demonstrated by the rise from C up to E flat, with the G descending back down to C in the next bar to complete the first motif. So far, we've only experienced a range of up to a fifth, which signifies restraint and control. However, in the next two bars, we expand this range, beginning on A flat and working our way back down to middle C before an octave leap to the higher C and settling down a perfect fourth to the G. So this second motif is a little bit more adventurous, but not too much, as we're still essentially holding a C pedal in the high string tremolo, and the last two notes of this motif are still outlining the tonic chord of C minor. The second half of the antecedent phrase opens with the same high C we reached before the A flat drops down a tritone to D natural and then rises back up to the A flat. As you might expect, this tritone introduces a sense of urgency and uncomfortability that is quickly resolved in the following measure, or bar 7. You can really appreciate how this use of an appoggiatura creates that slight bit of tension, as it shows that the melody isn't always consonant, predictable, and comfortable. Finally, in bars 8 to 9, we start on an F, which could imply the minor 4 chord or F minor. It could then resolve up to the flat 6 or A flat major due to the melody containing E flat, then A flat, before transitioning to a D, which could be implying the major 5 chord or G major. I find it really interesting how Williams decided to go with A flat before the D, as this not only implies the A flat major chord, but again brings in that tritone that creates that uneasy feeling. He could have just as easily replaced the A-flat with a C, and this would imply the one chord going to the 5, which would still have worked, but potentially not as effectively. The consequent phrase is when the magic really begins. As the melody repeats, this time in the violin ensemble, instead of starting on the tonic chord, Williams decides to begin on the submediant, or the 6th chord, in this case A flat major. I love this because the submediant chord still plays a tonic function, but because it's a major chord, there's an immediate sense of hope and brightness. Not only this, but in bar 11 we resolve to C major, or the parallel major of our home key. So far, we haven't heard any E naturals, so this shift from E flat up a semitone to E natural in these two chords respectively opens up a new color that we were in no way expecting. Among other composers, Williams popularized the use of chromatic medians in today's musical landscape, or the shifting of a chord up or down a major or minor third. The A flat major and C major chords only have the C in common, so this transition still sounds smooth and fluid even though the color changes drastically due to the other two notes moving from E flat up to E natural and A flat down to G. We then get the same device in the next two bars, except with the A flat major chord in first inversion to maintain a C pedal and this grounded tonic sensation. Bar 14 until the end is where the melody takes on new life, going up even higher to E flat as our climax before working its way back down to middle C, creating a very strong resolution. Bar 16 is especially beautiful as we're now fully embracing the tritone movement in the chord progression from A flat major down to D major. The latter chord presents one final squeeze of tension before submitting to the perfect authentic cadence, a truly beautiful sequence. You also notice that the bassline is extremely smooth here, walking down from E-flat to D to C, then reversing direction back up to D and then E-flat. It then descends one more time by step to D for the D major chord before jumping down the tritone once more to set up the cadence. One more thing to mention is the gorgeous contrary motion happening in bars 14 and 15, where the melody reaches higher while the bass descends. Then they come back in together for the D half diminished 7 chord. This expanding movement creates a warm feeling of embracing a loved one and understanding, which is simply gorgeous in this context. I also love how the melody in bar 16 descends by semitone, building that bit of tension before we go all in, with a melody jumping from F down a tritone to B natural, or the leading tone. Then, finally, after the dust settles, we resolve up very naturally to the tonic. After this, the piece continues to develop and the main theme is restated, but focusing on the core theme itself allows us to garner insights into Williams' writing process and how he uses harmonic devices to create changes in color and mood. It's not surprising given his background as a jazz musician, but still impressive nonetheless when you consider all he's done for Star Wars and what he continues to produce. Personally, it took me a few times of repeated listening before I really started to remember the theme, but I have a feeling that Williams wasn't going for immediate memorability here. I get the sense that he was aiming for a slightly more refined, mature, and reflective tone in this theme, and I think in that sense he pulled it off magnificently. You may not think that it's his catchiest or most iconic piece in his repertoire, but we have to understand that our musical tastes change and evolve as we mature and grow as human beings. Composers are no exception. Even though it's still Star Wars, the way John Williams approached this piece shows careful consideration in his thematic writing and harmonic vocabulary, and we should definitely respect that. That being said, I am interested in hearing what you think. Do you enjoy Obi-Wan Kenobi's theme, or does it sound derivative, boring, and not like John Williams at all? Let me know in a comment below. And like I mentioned at the very beginning, if you are a composer and want a step-by-step framework to speed up your workflow, you'll definitely want to download the free guide below, The Ideal Composing Workflow. I found this method to not only work for myself, but hundreds of other musicians as well, and I'd like to share it with you to help you with your music. Thank you so much for watching, and if you'd like to check out how I personally approach orchestration, click this video right here to see how I put together a full Disney orchestral medley from start to finish. Orchestration is a key element in making our production sound amazing, so you definitely don't want to miss this. Thanks again, and catch you in the next one. Take care.